On est là pour parler de la génération Z et je crois que vous aviez peut-être une étude, des choses à nous proposer côté Edelman. Edelman, vous pouvez être présenté en deux mots. Et, should we do everything in English, you think?
That would be very kind of you.
Okay, let's do it in English then.
I tried to ask for a translator, but the budget wasn't approved, unfortunately.
Don't worry, everybody speaks English in our universe. So we're here to talk about the Generation Z, Generation Z, as mm-hmm. they are called, mm-hmm. and what do they expect? And when they look at the media in general, how they see the media? Is there a fracture between old media and new media, and how does it work? And Harris is also from Generation Z, lab at Edelman. So tell us maybe first a few words about what you do at Edelman and why you think that it's important to look at what Generation Z thinks.
Great, I'll start. So hello everyone, my name's Amanda Edelman. I'm Chief Operating Officer of the Gen Z Lab at Edelman. We launched in June of this year, and our mission is to help companies and our clients engage more effectively with Gen Z. We think this is absolutely critical because Gen Z is a burgeoning consumer power. I'm sure many of you work with Gen Z and you know that they're really different from prior generations and they're absolutely changing the game. So a lot of our clients and businesses are feeling these effects of the new generation. And so we think it's really essential for them to understand the beliefs and motivators of this up and coming block of people.
Please. And I can pronounce it with French accent, it's brilliant. So I'm Cécile, I can say it with my normal accent. So I'm Cécile Nathan-Tillois. I'm also a member of Edelman family and I'm part of the nerd side. So I'm looking after the data and intelligence. So working very closely to make sure we study and try to get closer to that generation and understand them with a bit more depth than what we sometimes see.
And can I don't know if Harris can hear us and if he wants to say a few words as an introduction.
Harris?
Yes, so Harris actually is joining us via video. We have a recording of him to play after our presentation. So he's not here with us live today, but just recorded.
Okay, and yourself, do you have a presentation that you would like to
yes.
run?
Yes,
please.
Yes, we do.
The floor
okay.
is yours then.
Perfect. Great. So as you heard today, I'm Amanda Edelman, Chief Operating Officer of our Gen Z Lab.
Yeah. And I'm Cecile, and I'm part of the Data and Intelligence team.
Perfect. Great. So today we're here to talk to you about Gen Z. That's obviously what we do with the Gen Z Lab at Edelman. And to recap, we think it is so important because Gen Z is an up-and-coming power, but they're also influencing a lot of other demographics and people that were in society writ large. So I'll start today with just some information about why we should pay attention to Gen Z. And here we have a few statistics on how big they are and sort of their reach. So as we see here, they have $360 billion of disposable income broadly. There are over 2 billion people who belong to the Gen Z demographic, and they are over a quarter of the workforce in the next couple of years. So this is a generation that clearly has a lot of power and influence already. But unfortunately, they're a really misunderstood generation as well. So, for example, people believe that all of Gen Z wants to be influencers, which is not correct. Number two, people believe that Gen Z is out to cancel them, and over two-thirds believe that sharing is a form of activism. They're really not that radical. And number three, people, of course, believe that Gen Z is going to mobilize cancel culture against them, when again, for Gen Z, it's really just about accountability. Number four, Gen Z believes tech solves everything. Actually, less than half believe that tech is the solution to most problems. And then very lastly, people believe that Gen Z loves TikTok above all else, and actually Gen Z loves TikTok more, loves YouTube more than Gen Z. So all in all, this generation is widely misunderstood. And what Gen Z actually cares about is a lot more similar to other generations. For them, they're a generation that's deeply sensible, so they care about financial security, emotional security, and physical security in the way that all the other generations do. They're very globally unified, so data that we've seen from Mexico is similar to data in France, is similar to data in China, and when you think about the influences that they have, which is all through social media, it's all globalized. And of course, very lastly, they trust differently because they're exposed to a lot of different forces today than prior generations. And of course, why we think that this is so important is not only because Gen Z is an up-and-coming power in their own right, but because they influence all other generations in really basic tenets of what they do. So for example, 58% of the general population says that Gen Z influences what they buy, 52% what causes they support, 63% say that Gen Z influences workplace culture. I don't know if many of you have experienced this around remote work or, you know, why do young people not want to work today? These are some trends that we've been hearing, but these things are affecting workplaces broadly. And then very lastly, over half say that Gen Z is influencing their financial behavior, for example, in investing in things like cryptocurrency or in sort of digital investing tools. And the way that Gen Z is able to do this is because they dominate our public conversation globally. And this makes sense when you think about how much Gen Z is posting and living through online content and how much we turn to online content to inform our day-to-day conversations. And so you see on your right here, Gen Z is also changing how we consume news and how we consume entertainment. It's not only that Gen Z is doing these things completely differently than prior generations, they're also influencing how everyone today is consuming information, sharing information, things that are obviously very relevant in the field of media and journalism.
So when we look at Gen Z and their consumption of media, I know I'm not Gen Z, but I can do it. I think we got like, you know, very often continuing on these trends about misunderstanding, like Gen Z consumers consume more content than any other generation, but they spend less time with that content. So a very shortcut would be to think that actually they got kind of attention disorders, that they can't focus. Thank you. But actually, no, it's just that they are way more discerning. They are way more at ease about how they will engage with that content. And that's what we are saying, like, you know, they still have a relationship with traditional media. They still go there to get information. They believe, you can see here, both the global number, but also the French number. They believe traditional media content is absolutely true and trustworthy. So there still is a connection with, like, you know, the traditional way of getting your information. Only half, 52. But the older ones are not more positive. So they still very aligned with other generations. In terms of their media consumption, as like, you know, yes, they are spending awful lot of time on TikTok, but also on YouTube and all of the other platforms. It's the diversity of channels they would go through during their day and their weeks that makes also them very unique. And when we are looking as well, like, you know, when they are trusting news, you can see that YouTube is really the winner. May that be globally, but also in France. And it's interesting because, like, you know, when you look, we all know that stat that YouTube took over on Google in terms of search, for instance. They go here to have information. But what they do, most importantly, is the fact checking. These guys do not take things at face value. They will go check, look at different sources to make sure they get the facts right. So they are also telling us how to relearn how to consume when we got so much content being around us.
Yep. So before I dive into this section, I want to take a step back and have us all think about this generation and what they've been through for the past few years. It's obviously been a really stressful time for everyone, but particularly if you're a young person. You've been uprooted from school because of COVID. You've completely lost your sense of community because you're not around your friends. You're only around your family. And when you think of other issues that Gen Z is facing, like climate change, many of them were also impacted financially in the past couple of years because of COVID and inflation. It's been a really tough time. And because of COVID and other elements, Gen Z has started to seek community in online ways. And there's been a really interesting interplay between social media and Gen Z and sort of brands on social media, where Gen Z has actually started to find and create community online. Again, a trend that we already saw prior to COVID, but that COVID really accelerated. And so for them, they view community as both, you know, in the physical real world, but also in the digital world. And so in a world in which everyone and everything is on social media, Gen Z sees themselves as part of an entire community filled with not only their friends, but also filled with brands, filled with influencers. They're all part of this sort of digital ecosystem and digital community. So basically, when you think of a community, you also need to start with sources of inspiration and trust. And particularly for Gen Z, who are very young, they're constantly looking to this community for people on whom they should reflect their behaviors and actions. And this is a very interesting stat because it's actually quite contrary to what people believe, but Gen Z actually really trusts experts. So when you look at the people, particularly in France, who they trust most, it's doctors, it's teachers, it's scientists. People who are part of their real life community who they can turn to and trust. And people who they don't really trust are CEOs, activists, government leaders, people who feel really far away. And I mean, it proves it out. For Gen Z, particularly in France, inspiration is from real people. It's people who are their family members, it's people who are their friends, it's ordinary people who are doing good. Again, this is really contrary to what many believe about Gen Z, which is they all look up to these aspirational figures. Really, for Gen Z, their trust and their inspiration comes from people really close to home. And on the flip side, of course, people who they don't trust so much, it's philanthropists, it's faith leaders, it's politicians. Also up here, I'm sorry to break it to this this room, is journalists in France, who are also quite low at 31%. Again, these are people who seem very distant, who they don't have daily interaction with or face-to-face interaction with.
So when we look as well, like, you know, one of the learning is how do they like to basically connect with advertisers in media, and the way they're trying to engage with brand, there needs to be an emotional bond and a two-way dialogues. So it's also thinking of media really change how we allow brands to connect with them through advertising through our different medias. We need to rethink that because they need to be able to talk, to exchange, and we need to be as media also conveying that conversation and offering that, that possibility. Sorry. What was also, like, you know, interesting is how they are using, like, you know, the different channels. And you can see, like, you know, the numbers are quite kind of peaking when you're looking at the younger Gen Z and also, like, the slightly older. But it is about expression. It is about playing their creativity, sharing about their lives, but also, like, trying to be heard. So really opening that dialogue so they can bring who they are and create content is really key.
So we have three takeaways that I think maybe formatting has sort of changed, but I'll talk through them. So the first is for us to lean into Gen Z's gravitational pull. The first part of this presentation was really to convince you for why they're so important, which is A, because they're a growing power in their own right. Again, when you think of the demographics of this generation, they are 2 billion people across the world who are earning more and more money every day, who are reading more and more news, who are contributing more to the world. Not only that, but they also widely influence other generations and are responsible for a lot of changes that we're seeing in the world today. So number one, lean into Gen Z's gravitational pull because of that. Number two is to embrace media as more than an information channel, but a change agent. And what I mean by that is Gen Z, because they've grown up on social media, they're used to engaging in dialogue. They don't want information presented in a unidirectional way. They want to talk about it, they want to ask questions, they want to engage. So as journalists and as media, if you're able to really talk with Gen Z, to engage with them rather than dictate to them, that's when you're able to engage them the most. And then the very last thing is to consistently belong to communities. Again, for Gen Z, because of COVID and because they're primarily interacting with people in the digital sphere, their definition of community has completely changed. And they're open to community in a lot of different forms. So for brands, for media, for anyone, if you're able to engage and create community in an online setting, that is a really great way to speak to Gen Z, engage with them, and sort of get them on your page. And that's all we have for you today. We also, actually, that's all for a presentation we have for you today. Yes, we also have a short video, so someone could play the Harris video.
And the video is
Press show with a bag full of pre-rolls. No fit in the crowd full of free hoes. Feel brave as I walk to the stage and I tell them to behave as I put them in a daze. I been bold when I been bad. Bitch mad when I give a man whiplash. I can talk your bait as a quick cash. Sexy walk my way to a big day. Hit the bank and I cash out. Same way I hit the booth and I lash out. No, I ain't have fear for the passion. Go to work from the first to the last, yeah. Do a little lap dance for the black man. Let him hit it from the backside with a backhand. Front side. got the right time.
I think we're like the first, we're the first generation to really own media. We do it our way on our own terms, and we, you know, are the journalists now. We are the photographers. We are the, you know, I don't want to say interviewers, but we are literally everything in one. And I think, you know, media is changing in the fact that, you know, I have a 6 p.m. timer. All my fellow Gen Zer friends who own businesses, actors, directors, producers have, and it goes off at 6 p.m. If we have content to post, we're posting that content our way to our people in our language. So it's really about us owning that narrative around what our communication is and what the media is we're putting out there. I think Gen Z is going to completely change the world of media. I think when you literally have, you know, if I look at who I get my media from, there's probably only one thing in there that's actually a media source. The rest of it is all individual creators themselves that are Gen Zers on Instagram, TikTok, Twitter, all across every platform. So I think, you know, when no one's really going to read an old school story anymore, it's really going to start this kind of chain effect of all of us really being our own content creators in the global sense. So I think media is going to have to, well, it has to change in a massive way, because if not, you're going to miss the boat. And I think when you can have someone creating content from their bedroom with no money, and it's getting way more views and interactions than a glossy $100 million, you know, campaign socialite that's put in a massive way that's all flashy and all, you know, glitz and glam, then you can see that we have, you know, a big change that's ahead of us.
So my question was, how do media companies embrace that individual who is kind of soaring above, far and beyond what they're doing?
I think it's about bringing those individuals in as like consultants and people to actually train your staff and the people that are there. I think, yes, definitely embrace them, bring them on, give them a segment, give them a piece, give them a platform, which I think is most important, giving people platforms, but also really bring that person in to actually consult and further enhance your existing team. And I think that's when you kind of are ahead of the curve, is when you embrace it, you don't reject it, and you take it in and you make something special with it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amanda. Thank you very much for telling Merce about Gen Z. On va faire un petit break et on sera de retour d'ici une dizaine de minutes avec cet après-midi. On va parler d'audiovisuel, services publics, diversité dans la création et cinéma, je crois. Je n'oublie peut-être rien. Et ensuite, influenceurs. Donc, je vous donne rendez-vous d'ici une dizaine de minutes pour poursuivre nos débats. Merci à toutes et à tous. À tout de suite.